Next, we're going to move on to the debate between Bill Nye and Ken Ham.
Ken Spam.
Retard.
And the thing is about it is Bill Nye, we cut him out of most of it. At the end, we have a little snippet, his closing statement, which says a lot. But
Bill Nye, the science guy.
We're going to debate Ken Ham. We're going to debate what he said in each clip. And
Ken Ham, the bullshit man.
It's kind of funny because I forgot about Ken Ham after I watched Religious. I was kind of like, oh, that crazy guy that runs the dinosaur museum down in Kentucky.
The Flintstones Museum, yeah. I like to call it.
Yeah, because they have, like, kids riding dinosaurs with saddles on them.
Well, they have, like, a dinosaur with a saddle, and they're like, this is how it was.
I think my grandpa probably rode a dinosaur around, though, so that's kind of cool, I think, you know. They were different times. You know, they didn't have...
My great-great-granddaddy was a T-Rex farmer.
They didn't have cars then. You have to understand, TJ.
You have to understand that T-Rexes were like giant chickens.
And that's what the Bible
says. And pterodactyls
says.
Were used for like air transportation, right?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
The funniest thing about the whole debate was, you know, Bill Nye was coming from a scientific point of view and matching facts with evidence. And then Ken Ham's whole thing is taking evidence and trying to make it fit with the Bible. So he starts with a predetermined point of view and then tries to make the evidence fit with it.
It's like the flip side, like it's a variation on guilty until proven innocent. This is where you start with a conclusion and work your way back from there. Yeah. And ignore all evidence that contradicts your conclusion.
This is Ken Ham's opening statement at the debate.
Well, good evening. I know that not everyone watching this debate will necessarily agree with what I have to say, but I'm an Aussie and live over here in America, and they tell me I have an accent, and so it doesn't matter.
You know, it's kind of funny. I know Ray Comfort is from New Zealand, all the Aussies out there. I know to Americans, your accents sound the same.
Yes.
But I've heard Ray Comfort start interviews this exact same way. Yeah, I have an accent, you know.
Like, that's the problem.
Yeah, whatever, man.
Like,
I don't care.
Yeah, it's we don't care if you're a Kiwi or an Aussie. You know, it doesn't really affect the debate. That's not even an issue.
I have an accent. I can't do
what I say. Some people tell me we just like you hear saying it. So I hope you enjoy me saying it anyway. Well, the debate topic is this. Is creation a viable model of origins in today's modern scientific era? You know, when this was first announced on the internet, there are lots of statements like this one from the Richard Dawkins Foundation. Scientists should not debate creationists, period. And this one from one of the Discovery.com websites. Should scientists debate creationists? You know, right here I believe there's a gross misrepresentation in our culture. We're seeing people in being indoctrinated to believe that creationists can't be scientists. I believe it's all a part of secularists hijacking the word science. I want you to meet a modern-day scientist who is a biblical creationist.
My name.
So what he's about to do is he's going to play little video snippets from scientists who are also creationists.
There's a common misconception that alchemists cannot also be chemists.
And lead cannot be turned into gold.
Yeah, so
There's a strange notion that magicians who believe in magic and dragons can't be imperial rational people. Empiricists.
So the people you're about to hear are scientists. They really are. And there are people that Ken Ham asked to kind of testify on his behalf. And it's kind of funny because one thing that I noticed during his whole slideshow thing, it really reminded me of a Kent Hovind slideshow when he was doing it.
You're a fucktard, aren't you, Kent?
I want you to meet a modern-day scientist who is a biblical creationist.
My name is Stuart Burgess. I'm a professor of engineering design at Bristol University in the UK. My name is Stuart Burgess. I'm a professor of engineering design at Bristol University in the UK.
I live in a realm of pure echo.
I've published over 130 scientific papers on the science of design in engineering and biological systems. From my research work, I have found that the scientific evidence fully supports creationism as the best explanation to origins. I've also designed major parts of spacecraft launched by ESA and NASA.
So here's a biblical creationist who's a scientist who's also an inventor. And I want young people to understand that. You know, the problem I believe is this. We need to define terms correctly. We need to define creation, evolution in regard to origins, and we need to define science. And in this opening statement, I want to concentrate on dealing with the word science. I believe the word science has been hijacked by secularists. Now, what is science? Well, the origin of the word comes from the classical Latin scientia, which means to know. And if you look up a dictionary, it'll say science means state of knowing, knowledge. But there's different types of knowledge, and I believe this is where the confusion lies.
And look,
there's experimental...
I've read the Bible, and I know it's true. That is science.
Yeah, he goes... That's pretty much his closing statement.
I love his... He brings on the engineer, who I'm sure is reasonably accomplished as an engineer. But that's not really... He's not really in the life sciences. This is not some preeminent biologist who's saying evolution is bullshit.
Even if he were, does it really make a difference? Because where is the facts and evidence to back it up? You can pull out some guy like, this guy has all these degrees and he has all this prestige, but if he's saying something that's total nonsense that evidence does not support, does it really matter?
Yeah, I mean, it's an argument from authority. Like, hey, ignore the evidence because, hey, we have this guy. We produce this guy who's an engineer of some note who believes in creationism. Therefore, creationism is true.
Observational science, as we call it. That's using the scientific method, observation, measurement, experiment, testing. That's what produces our technology, computers, spacecraft, jet planes, smoke detectors, looking at DNA, antibodies.
But somehow it magically fails when it comes to evolution. It can produce, like, when the scientific method is applied to the present, it can produce all of these technological wonders. But when we try to apply it to the past, then all of a sudden it's fucked up and wonky. Magically.
And vaccines. You see, all scientists, whether creationists or evolutionists, actually have the same observational or experimental science. And it doesn't matter whether you're a creationist or an evolutionist, you can be a great scientist. For instance, here's an atheist who is a great scientist, Craig Venter, one of the first researchers to sequence the human genome. Or Dr. Raymond Damadian. He is a man who invented the MRI scanner and revolutionized medicine. He's a biblical creationist. But I want us to also understand, molecules to man evolution belief has nothing to do with developing technology. You see, when we're talking about origins, we're talking about the past. We're talking about our origins. We weren't there. You can't observe that, whether it's molecules to man evolution or whether it's a creation account. When you're talking about the past, we like to call that origins or historical science, knowledge concerning the past. Here at the Creation Museum, we make no apology about the fact that our origins or historical science actually is based upon the biblical account of origins. Now, when you research science textbooks being used in public schools, what we found is this. By and large, their origins or historical science is based upon man's ideas about the past, for instance, the ideas of Darwin. And our research has found that public school textbooks are using the same word science for observational science and historical science. They arbitrarily define science as naturalism and outlaw the supernatural. They present molecules to man evolution as fact. They are imposed.
There's nothing outlawing the supernatural. It's just that once you discover it, once you classify it, once you understand something about how it works, it's no longer supernatural.
Exactly.
Then it becomes something that is melded into whatever the naturalistic worldview is.
He's trying to make this differentiation between observational science and historical science, which really there isn't a difference.
There's, you know,
well, he's trying to say, well, you remember in the beginning he said science means to know. So what he's trying to say is, like, they weren't there, they don't know.
Oh, yeah, he says that a lot of times.
That's sort of his mantra during this debate. You weren't there. You don't know. And by that, I'm glad that he's not in charge of criminal investigations, because you could basically dismiss any crime. Even like, oh, well, his DNA evidence of the killer was found on the scene and under the victim's fingernails.
How do we know that the Roman Empire existed? We weren't there. We don't know.
Well, that's in the Bible, though.
Hey, but, you know...
He wasn't there. He doesn't know.
They weren't there. They don't know.
But the Bible was there, and we trust the Bible.
Okay, so the Bible was there. So that's the only reason we know it exists.
Yes.
Okay.
Losing, I believe, the religion of naturalism or atheism on generations of students. You see, I assert that the word science has been hijacked by secularists in teaching evolution.
How many times have you said that?
The religion.
I swear he said that three times
already. Secularist and evolutionist. which, who uses those terms? Like, I've never heard of, I'm an evolutionist. It's like, I believe in evolution. I mean, I guess you want to call yourself an evolutionist.
It's almost like revolutionist. I don't know. It's...
Add an R.
...of naturalism on generations of kids. Secular evolutionists teach that all life developed by natural processes from some primordial form, that man is just an evolved animal, which has great bearing on how we view life and death. For instance, as Bill states...
It's very hard to accept for many of us that when you die, it's over.
But you see, the Bible gives a totally different account of origins, of who we are, where we came from, the meaning of life, and our future. That through one man, sin entered the world, and death
well,
through
now
sin.
He's making, but, now he's making an emotional appeal, like, you know, if the atheists are right, then you just go
well,
in the fucking
ground. I mean,
ground
by the same
rot.
Argument, how do we know why do we give the Bible such importance? How do we know the Bible is correct? I mean, like, well, it's the word of God, but how do we know that?
But I mean, I just love
it. Just goes back and back.
I just love
circle.
How it's like, oh, the atheists, they just view the world as a piece of shit, but the Bible, that gives you hope. Like, what does that have to do with truth? I mean, there's plenty of propositions that are more hopeful than others. That doesn't make them more truthful. I mean, it's a. I would definitely prefer to have, like, a gigantic cock, but I don't. That doesn't mean I do just because that would be better. I mean, no. That's not how it works. So.
That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, whoever believes in him should not perish and have everlasting life. So, is creation a viable model of origins in today's modern scientific era? I say the creation evolution debate is a conflict between two philosophical worldviews based on two different accounts of origins or science beliefs, and creation is the only viable model of historical science confirmed by observational science in today's modern scientific era.
Bullshit.
You know what? It sounds, he almost sounds exactly like Venom Fang X. You know, if you go back like 5-6 years ago, the type of videos Venom Fang X used to make.
Oh, yeah, that's so true.
Yeah.
They all read from the same basic script and drink from the same fountain of bullshit, so it's no wonder that they regurgitate each other's talking points.
Oh, of course.
Of course, I mean, pretty much any group will do that to an extent. But, I mean, when it just becomes more apparent when what the message being preached is such obvious
bullshit. And notice that this isn't a scientific debate. This is a philosophical debate.
That's
all it is.
There is no debate within the scientific community. Just because you can rattle up a few scientists who support creationism, that doesn't represent any sort of, like, reasonably large cross-section of scientists. The vast majority of scientists do accept evolution. Even the ones who are religious, for the most part, accept that evolution happened.
Yeah, I mean, there are even scientists that are also Catholic priests that work for the Vatican Observatory, for example, that do not accept the creation myth. Basically, as a scientist, as a true scientist, you cannot accept that. So these people that believe in the Bible are still scientists, and they take science as fact, and they take the Bible as allegory.
It's like in Star Trek, where the Klingons basically have this primitive civilization, and then they're civilized. A Federation attempts to civilize them and gives them all this futuristic technology, which they then use to just continue fighting their, you know, the conflicts they were already entrenched in. This is the same thing. It's just like, hey, this old world philosophy that's totally incompatible with modernity is now being spread by the means of technology that it could never have produced itself, because its views are so antithetical to any sort of environment that could actually produce, you know, the technological wonders that allow something like this debate to even happen.
And I mean, it's not
your
like...
Your report describes how rational these people are. Millennia ago, they abandoned their belief in the supernatural. Now you are asking me to sabotage that achievement, to send them back into the dark ages of superstition and ignorance and fear? No!
Yeah,
that was just all too appropriate.
It was.
Yeah, it was completely appropriate.
So the last clip we heard was Ken Ham's introduction. So here's a few more snippets of things he had to say throughout the debate. Reminding everyone, we did cut Bill Nye out. We're going to debate Ken Ham almost as if Bill Nye wasn't even there. And actually, he was very quiet every time he got on stage.
Well, the debate topic was, is creation a viable model of origins in today's modern scientific era? And I made this statement at the end of my opening statement. Creation is the only viable model of historical science confirmed by observational science in today's modern scientific era. And I said, what we need to be doing
if only the damn scientists would acknowledge it.
Terms, and particularly three terms, science, creation, and evolution. Now, I discussed the meaning of the word science and what is meant by experimental or observational science briefly, and that both creationists and evolutionists can be great scientists, for instance. I mentioned Craig Venter, a biologist, he's an atheist, and he's a great scientist. He was one of the first researchers to sequence a human genome. I also mentioned Dr. Raymond Damadian, who actually invented the MRI scanner. I want you to meet a biblical creationist who is a scientist and inventor.
Hi, my name is Dr. Raymond Damadian. I am a young Earth creation scientist and believe that God created the world in 6 24-hour days, just as recorded in the book of Genesis. By God's grace and the devoted prayers of my godly mother-in-law, I invented the MRI scanner in 1969. The idea that scientists who believe the Earth is 6,000 years old cannot do real science is simply wrong.
Well, he's most adamant about that. And actually, he revolutionized medicine. He's a biblical creationist. And I encourage children to follow.
I think it's important to note that it is very possible for people to compartmentalize certain aspects of their beliefs and personality. And, you know, I think that when you're inventing the magnetic resonance imaging system, whatever, you know, it's not really going to come into play the age of the Earth or,
no.
You know, how life was created. That's not even something that you're going to be addressing.
Yeah, it's completely irrelevant to the subject.
Yeah, and it doesn't really lend any credibility. I mean, the fact of the matter is that the majority of the scientific community believes in evolution, accepts evolution. In fact, many who work in biological sciences or genetics, they couldn't even do their job without evolution, because everything they do is contingent upon the fact that this happened.
But TJ, you weren't there. You don't know.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. I forgot.
You would have to have been there for millions of years watching these animals evolve to prove that. But even then, it would be impossible because the Earth is only, what, 6,000 years old?
You ever seen a chimp give birth to a human?
Why are there still monkeys, TJ? Why are there still monkeys?
I don't have facts to back this up.
Maybe Ken Ham's mom.
People like that and make them their heroes. Let me introduce you to another biblical creation scientist.
My name is Danny Faulkner. I received my PhD in astronomy from Indiana University. For 26 and a half years, I was professor at the University of South Carolina, Lancaster, where I hold the rank of Distinguished Professor Emeritus. Upon my retirement from the university in January of 2013, I joined the research staff at Answers in Genesis. I'm a stellar astronomer. That means my primary interest is stars, but I'm particularly interested in the study of eclipsing binary stars.
I wonder if that means that he believes that the light from the stars was created already on its way to Earth. Because the light from some of these stars takes millions of years to reach us. Billions of years, I think, in some cases.
That was something that Bill Nye mentioned. Was, you know, if you only believe that the universe is 6,000 years old, how is it that these stars that are, you know, tens of thousands of light years away, if not more, are visible in the night sky?
God.
Yeah. That's
the only possible response they can have is God.
God just made the light on its way here, TJ, because he figured we'd enjoy the show.
Do you remember that crazy guy that was like, you were like debating him through like email or something? He was like, okay, well, if you flip a coin, how do you know what it's going to land on or whatever? You know, heads or tails, or roll a dice? And remember his answer, God decides. There's no probability God decides.
The evidence he gave me for God was, he said, well, I was in this car crash, and they said that the odds of me surviving were 1 in a million. And I'm like, okay, so you were just the 1 in a million then. And he's like, no, it's because God decided. I was like, okay, well, if you flip a coin, and there's a 50% chance it's going to be heads, and there's a 50% chance it's going to be tails, and it lands on tails, does that mean God decided? And he said, yes.
Which means there's no such thing as free will.
There's no such thing as free will or probability or chance or anything like that.
All right. I'm glad he covered that for us.
Many articles in the astronomy literature, places such as the Astrophysical Journal, the Astronomical Journal, and the Observatory. There is nothing in observational astronomy that contradicts a recent creation.
I also mentioned Dr. Stuart Burgess, professor of design.
How is there not? I just pointed one out, and I'm a layman. I don't get that. Okay.
We need the cricket sound effect.
Yeah, we need to get a cricket sound, like the chirp, because Bill Hicks could do it himself, but I can't do it. Because he could just, I don't know how he did that, but he was able to master the cricket noise. We just need to get an actual cricket.
Yes.
Design, engineering design at Bristol University in England. Now, he invented, designed a double-action worm gear set for the three hinges of the robotic arm on a very expensive satellite. And if that had not worked, if that gear set had not worked, that whole satellite would have been useless. Yet Dr. Burgess is a biblical creationist who believes just as I believe. Now,
what does that have to do with him creating a retractable arm on a satellite?
He's just trying to build the credibility of the people he's talking
he's
about.
The contention that he's basically trying to put forward here is that there are scientists who have accomplishments under their belt, who have done things of note, who happen to be creationists.
None in biology or zoology or any
I'm sure
applicable
field. I'm sure you could even find someone there. I mean, because it's just, there's so many scientists, and creationism is a thing that exists, and there are people that are going to be brainwashed towards it
especially
for purely ideological reasons.
Especially in the United States, where there's so much Christian fundamentalism, but we also have a higher education system which can produce people like this.
So, just pointing to some scientists, say, look, this guy invented some shit, and he believes me. That doesn't do it for
me. Yeah, where is your evidence? I mean, that's the thing lacking in this. They talk about these guys' great achievements, like, he designed the satellite arm, and it's like, okay, what does this have to do with creationism?
Think about this for a moment. Are scientists like Dr. Burgess, who believe in creation, just as I do, a small minority in the scientific world? But let's see what he says about scientists believing in creation.
I find that many of my colleagues in academia are sympathetic to the creationist viewpoint, including biologists. However, they are often afraid to speak out because...
I think that's kind of... I mean, obviously this isn't a trial, but that's sort of hearsay, isn't it?
Yeah.
I know people who are biologists.
I know some obscure random people that I will not mention by name, but they definitely think we're right. It's like, you know, they're scared to speak the truth. Why would they be afraid to speak the truth? I mean, the scientific community is kind of based around the proposition that, like, hey, if there's evidence, if there's something you can prove or show, we're willing to acknowledge or to listen to it.
Yeah, but we're being told now that the scientific community basically just rejects this because it's been taken over by the secularist agenda.
I mean, that's not to say that the scientific community is just completely open to any idea. I mean, it's not like there's some pushback even against ideas and theories that have been shown later to be correct, but, you know, been rejected by the establishment, but this is not really one of them. I mean, this is something that just goes back to, you know, this theist mindset of, oh, okay, well, this is everything we know about the Earth is explained in the Bible. That's all we need to know. We don't really, science is just trying to destroy religion and contradict us, and this is wrong.
But it's not even real science. It's the fake science of the secularists with their humanist agenda.
It's like a fake TV show scientist, like The Big Bang Theory or something.
They would get from the media and atheist lobby.
I agree. That's a real problem today. We need to have freedom to be able to speak on these topics.
The atheist lobby? I'm unaware
what?
Of such a lobby.
They need the freedom to speak. Okay, they're having a debate right now, but they're not free to discuss the issue.
Okay, he has a museum dedicated to his bullshit ideas. No one's closed it down. No one said, hey, fuck this. I mean, plenty of people said, fuck this, but no one's ever actually prevented them from doing it.
But he doesn't have any freedom to basically have the right to have his opinion heard and basically his beliefs, like freedom of speech.
I'd be interested to know if the museum gets any public funding.
I seriously doubt it.
Okay.
But it's possible.
I'm not going to assume, but I'm wondering.
I just want to say, by the way, that non-Christian scientists, I should say, non-Christian scientists are really borrowing from the Christian worldview anyway to carry out their experimental or observational science. Think about
what?
When they're doing...
Did you have a comment? Or
no, I was just saying, what?
Okay.
Observational science using the scientific method, they have to assume the laws of logic, they have to assume the laws of nature, they have to assume the uniformity of nature. I mean, think about it. If the universe came about by natural processes, where'd the laws of logic come from? Did they just pop into existence? Are we in a stage now where we only have half logic? So you see, I have a question for Bill Nye. How do you account for the laws of logic and the laws of nature from a naturalistic worldview that excludes the existence of God?
Wouldn't the logic of whatever universe happened to exist be tailored to the laws and principles of that universe?
Yes.
So I mean, like any universe, no matter what the principles that govern it happen to be, is going to have its own laws of logic.
Well, that's the whole point of Earth science in general, is explaining this without saying God did it. So
God done it.
And yeah.
Interesting thing he said was like, okay, this Christian worldview, but the earliest writings I know of on logic and things like that were Greek, so that predate Christianity by. Well,
but you have to understand that within his worldview, nothing predates Christianity.
Zeus did it.
Because their world starts with Adam and Eve and God saying, hey, don't eat that fucking fruit, you dumb kids.
Where is there evidence that occurred, though?
In the Bible.
The Bible is not evidence.
It is. It is evidence.
How so?
It's evidence of the gullibility of the human species.
Ham will go on to explain how it is evidence.
Okay, cool.
This should be amusing.
Now, in my opening statement, I also discussed a different type of science or knowledge, origins or historical science. See, again, there's a confusion here. There's a misunderstanding here. People, by and large, have not been taught to look at, you know, what you believe about the past as different to what you're observing in the present. You don't deserve the, you don't observe the past directly. Even, you know, when you think of...
Okay, but, like, you understand that, you know, things that happened in the past, they can still leave evidence behind. Like, if you go to a crime scene and there's, you know, hey, this guy's DNA is all over the place and, you know, his skin is under the victim's fingernails and... You know,
you weren't there.
He took out a giant life insurance policy on her 2 weeks before he killed her. I mean, you know, there's things that you can look at and say, aha, I can piece this puzzle back together. And he's basically saying, no, you can't do that. That's impossible. The only way to do that is either reading the Bible or having been there.
Yeah.
About the creation account. I mean, we can't observe God creating. We can't observe the creation of Adam and Eve. We admit that. We're willing to admit our beliefs about the past. But see, what you see in the present is very different. Even some public school textbooks, actually, well, they sort of acknowledge the difference between historical and observational science. Here is an earth science textbook that's used in public schools, and we read this. In contrast to physical geology, the aim of historical geology is to understand Earth's long history. And then they make the statement, historical geology, so we're talking about historical science, tries to establish a timeline of the vast number of physical and biological changes that have occurred in the past. We study physical geology before historical geology because we first must understand how Earth works before we try to unravel its past. In other words, we observe things in the present and then, okay, we're assuming that that's always happened in the past and we're going to try and figure out how this happened. See, there is a difference.
That's not even... an accurate summation of how that process works.
I don't know what's going on. It's like this guy's drunk at a bar rambling.
Oh, my.
Difference between what you observe and what happened in the past. Let me illustrate it this way. If Bill Nye and I went to the Grand Canyon, we could agree that that's a Coconino sandstone in the Hermit Shale, and there's the boundary. They're sitting one on top of the other. We could agree on that. But do you know what we would disagree on? I mean, we could even analyze the minerals and agree on that. But we would disagree on how long it took to get there.
Yeah, but only because you're stupid. Like, the fact that you come to this disagreement doesn't show the science is irrelevant. It shows that you're a moron.
But see, none of us saw the sandstone or the shale being laid down. There's a supposed 10 million year gap there. But I don't see a gap. But that might be different to what Bill Nye would see. But see, there's a difference between what you actually observe directly and then your interpretation in regard to the past.
The difference between Bill Nye's interpretation would have facts and evidence backing it up, whereas Ken Ham's would have the Bible.
And I don't understand. He just a moment ago was like, I understand we want there to see Adam and Eve and blah blah blah. So like, and I never heard the part where he justified why that's okay. I never heard why his own logic doesn't apply to him and his bullshit. He addressed like, and by the way, my shit, I wasn't there either. But and then he never goes on to explain, but it's okay because X.
Because people in the Bible observed it, because it's the word of God, inspired by God. So they observed the events he's talking about. I'm guessing that's what he's saying.
Okay. So basically, any should we just give absolute weight to any historical text? Because, I mean, like...
Yes.
There was this alchemist, I forget what his name was, but he actually claimed to have created miniature people by basically mixing human semen with bullshit, literally bullshit, the shit from bulls, and he said that little people came out. And the funny thing was, a bunch of other alchemists, probably not wanting to be shown up by this guy, said, yeah, we fucking did the same experiment and got the same result. We created little people. So should we just go back and read those accounts and assume, wow, I guess if you mix human semen with bullshit, you get a little person.
That's where we came from.
Because someone wrote it down in a book and observed it at some point, or claimed to have observed it. Well, because, as we all know, lying wasn't invented till around, like, 1980, so pretty much anything before that must
was
be
the
true.
That was the year Ronald Reagan got elected.
Yes.
Well, have you ever heard the theory of, like, pre-formatism, where, like, this guy, in, like, I think it was in Holland, like, was able to, like, use, like magnifying glass to look at his semen, and he saw, like, the, you know, obviously the sperm moving around, and he's like, oh, it must be little people. And I actually think that's what it was when they were having sex, was it was like basically like a little person was going into the woman and came out as like a baby.
That's kind of true.
I mean, but they thought it was actually like a very miniature human.
Like a little miniature, yes. Fully formed human, like, yeah. Swimming around like, whee, this is fun.
When I was at the Goddard Space Center a number of years ago, I met creationists and evolutionists who were both working on the Hubble telescope. They agreed on how to build the Hubble telescope. You know what they disagreed on? Well, they disagreed on how to interpret the data the telescope obtained in regard to the age of the universe. And, you know, we could go on and talk about lots of other...
I fucking seriously doubt that there was anyone working on the Hubble telescope that was a creationist. And if there was, I feel like it was probably a fucking few people.
It was probably the person welding all the parts together.
Yeah, I don't buy it.
Similar sorts of things. For instance... I've heard Bill Nye talk about how a smoke detector works using the radioactive element americium. And you know what? I totally agree with him on that. We agree how it works. We agree how radioactivity enables that to work. But if you're then going to use radioactive elements and talk about the age of the Earth, you've got a problem because you weren't there.
Oh,
we've got
okay.
to understand parent elements, daughter.
So he doesn't... Oh, I guess that makes sense that he wouldn't believe in radiometric dating or any sort of... process that would arrive.
Yeah,
he wouldn't
believe in carbon dating or any sort of dating like that using the basically the elements. Why would he do that? And that would disprove his argument.
So, that's a flat out denial of chemistry. It's like, oh no, we don't understand the half life of this particular element. We can't tell what's going on here.
Well, later on, he goes on to say that all of our scientific dating methods contradict one another.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah.
Elements and so on. We could agree whether you're a creationist or evolutionist on the technology to put the rover on Mars, but we're going to disagree on how to interpret the origin of Mars. I mean, there are some people that believe there was even a global flood on Mars and there's no liquid water on Mars. But... you know, we're going to disagree maybe on our interpretation of origins, and you can't prove either way because, not from an observational science perspective, because we've only got the present. Creationists and evolutionists both work on medicines and vaccines. You see, it doesn't matter whether you're a creationist or an evolutionist, all scientists have the same experimental or observational science. So I have a question
I'm
for
starting to. I'm starting to see the tactic
that Ken Ham is really using here, and it seems to be the tactic he's using throughout this debate, which is not this tactic of, like, creationism is correct. No. It seems to be his tactic is more like creationism is just every bit as legitimate as any other theory.
Exactly.
And also he says interpret over and over again. It's like, okay, most scientists really aren't trying to interpret. They're trying to discover, like, the truth. They're trying to back this up with evidence and facts and say, can we prove this?
They're trying to come up with a model that can be used to explain what's happening and also to be able to predict what is going to happen.
I mean, when he's saying that, it's like, well, we're trying to interpret. It's like, no, you're basically just trying to prove that creationism is correct. You know, I mean, that is your hypothesis.
That's why in the beginning he framed it as a philosophical argument so that he could make a philosophical argument, because he's clearly not going to make any sort of cogent scientific argument.
No.
I haven't heard him present one bit of evidence for creationism yet, and we're well into his segments of this debate.
Yeah, this is a 3-hour debate, and we're already well over the first hour mark.
And
Bill Nye said.
I have yet to hear one goddamn thing in support of creationism.
No, it's basically like, these other scientists agree with me.
Yeah, all I've heard is, we have scientific legitimacy. We have scientific legitimacy. We have scientific legitimacy. Okay, where's the evidence? Where's your actual argument that this proposition is true?
Can you name one piece of technology that could only have been developed starting with a belief in molecules to man evolution? Now, here's another important fact. Creationists and evolutionists all have the same
evidence. How about that? The dog.
He's going to bring up the dog.
He is?
Yeah, he's going to bring up how the dog is a kind, you know how they like to use kind, and how dogs have only ever produced other dogs.
Okay, but look at the fucking breadth and depth of, like, all the different forms of dogs that we have.
Yeah, I mean, you can have a dog that weighs 2 pounds and a dog that weighs almost 200 pounds.
And they're technically the same species because
they are.
Human beings
It's
have,
not even technical. They are.
Yeah, they're the same species because human beings have basically bred them in all of these different directions in all these different parts of the world.
It's unnatural selection.
Yes.
And they've also adapted in their own way to evolve to be, you know, basically human companions, reading, like, human facial expressions and body language.
It's like, but look, I mean, if we kept the dog around for long enough, it seems to me like there would come a point where there would be certain dog breeds that would be a species unto themselves. If that process just continued on for, say, you know, however, whatever amount of time it takes, or something like that.
A kind of interesting argument about dogs you could make, too, is, you know, it could have been part of dogs' evolution to just become closer to humans. Like, people could, you know, almost think, like, oh, you know, like, we're the ones responsible for this. But, I mean, in all reality, initially, it might have just been these animals saw a niche, which was like, hey, these other, you know, people provide us with, you know, food and shelter and protection, maybe it's a good idea for us to go hang around them.
Well, we have a very similar social structure to dogs, or at least we did in our hunter-gatherer days, because, you know, we were basically animals that lived in complex social groups and were hunters and scavengers.
Yeah.
And that's pretty much what a gray wolf is.
Bill Nye and I have the same Grand Canyon. We don't disagree on that. We will have the same fish fossil. This is one from the Creation Museum. The same dinosaur skeletons, the same animals, the same humans, the same DNA, the same radioactive decay elements that we see. We have the same universe. Actually, we all have the same evidences. It's not the evidences that are different. It's a battle over the same evidence in regard to how we interpret the past. And you know why that is? Because it's really a battle over worldviews and starting points. It's a battle over philosophical worldviews and starting points, but the same evidence. Now, I admit, my starting point is that God is the ultimate authority. But if someone doesn't accept that, then man has to be the ultimate authority. And that's really the difference when it comes down to it.
Why does there have to be an ultimate authority? And why does God have to be the starting point? When God is the starting point, there's no other real explanation for anything else. Why even bother studying science? You can just say God did it.
Yeah, it kind of goes back to the argument like we made earlier about the one guy. It's like God decides, like, why would you even bother doing anything or studying science? Because you already have, in his view, the basis of everything, which is God.
Yeah, why not just pray for everything to happen? You know,
we've already seen that with the parents charged with, you know, like child neglect, you know, praying their kids' cancer away, praying, you know, their other, you know, non-communicable.
So, yeah, this is just another...
I would also like to point out, if I could, yeah, that nothing Ken Ham has said so far could not be applied to any other religion or
yes,
conviction out there.
Yeah.
I mean, you could... It doesn't even matter. It barely even matters how obscure. As long as there's some segment of the population that believes in something, some of them are going to be scientists. That doesn't lend credibility to that hypothesis. I could find you plenty of fucking Muslim scientists. That doesn't mean Islam is right. I could find you plenty of scientists who think that 9/11 was an inside job. That doesn't mean that 9/11 was an inside job. I could find you tons of scientists who fucking... I might even be able to find you one that believes in Santa Claus. Doesn't mean Santa Claus is real.
Yeah,
I actually do believe in Santa Claus, you know.
But you're not a scientist.
But damn it, Scotty, you're fired.
I know.
Again.
Shit.
You're only the scientist of firedology.
The difference between historical origin science, knowledge about the past when you weren't there, and we need to understand that we weren't there. Or experimental,
how many times?
Observational science.
You want that, TJ. You want that.
You want fucking that. You don't know. You want that.
That's his number one argument.
You weren't there.
Nobody was there.
I walked into this room, and my mom had a gunshot in her head, and my dad was standing over holding a gun with smoke coming out of the barrel. Did you see him shoot her? Well, no. Well, you weren't there.
It's funny because was he there when all the biblical shit happened?
He's already admitted he wasn't, and I've yet to hear the explanation for why that's okay.
He didn't refute that.
It's using your five senses in the present, the scientific method, what you can directly observe, test, repeat. There's a big difference between those two. And that's not what's being taught in our public schools, and that's why kids aren't being taught to think critically and correctly about the origins issue.
Wow.
Irony! Just don't go down to Texas and Louisiana, because they do teach that there.
Irony.
This is the reason why kids aren't being taught to think critically.
Yeah, just finally accept whatever Ken Ham is telling you.
I love how his definition of critical thinking is to surrender your thought process to a 2,000-year-old anthology of even older myths that are contradictory from one book to the next, sometimes contradictory within the same book. I mean, there's two different accounts of Genesis, for fuck's sake. With a totally,
but you know, it's also important to understand.
With a totally different order of events.
Yeah.
But you know, it's also important to understand, when talking about creation evolution, both involve historical science and observational science. You see, the role of observational science is this: it can be used to confirm or otherwise one's historical science based on one's starting point. Now, when you think about the debate topic and what I affirmed concerning creation, if our origins or historical science based on the Bible, the Bible's account of origins is true, then there should be predictions from this that we can test using observational science.
Okay.
Now, for instance, based on the Bible...
So now he's finally getting into whatever his argument is.
Yeah,
This is his argument, I guess, for why the Bible can be, you know, taken as some transcendent authority beyond all others.
This is over an hour into the debate.
Yes, and he's finally getting to some meat.
We can test,
and it'll probably
using observational science, and there are. For instance, based on the Bible, we'd expect to find evidence confirming an intelligence produced life. We'd expect to find evidence confirming after their kind. The Bible says God made kinds of animals and plants after their kind, implying each kind produces its own, not that one kind changes into another. You'd expect to find evidence confirming a global flood of Noah's day. Evidence confirming one race of humans, because we all go back to Adam and Eve, biologically, that would mean there's one race. Evidence confirming the Tower of Babel, that God gave different languages. Evidence confirming a young universe. Now, I can't go through all of those, but
a couple of them
we'll look at briefly.
Okay. None of those, we don't have evidence confirming any of those. We have evidence to the contrary. That's why this debate is even necessary. I mean, that's literally the reason why you're here debating in the first place, is because the evidence doesn't show any of those things. Okay, let's go.
After their kind, evidence confirming that. In the Creation Museum, we have a display featuring replicas, actually, of Darwin's finches. They're called Darwin's finches. Darwin collected finches from the Galapagos and took them back to England, and we see the different species, the different beak sizes here. And, you know, from the specimens that Darwin obtained in the Galapagos, he actually pondered these things, and how do you explain this? And in his notes, actually, he came up with this diagram here, a tree. And he actually said, I think. So he was talking about different species, and maybe those species came from some common ancestor. Actually, when it comes to finches, we actually would agree as creationists that different finch species came from a common ancestor, but a finch is what they would have to come from. But you see, Darwin wasn't just thinking.
More than any argument that the creationists make, I detest this argument that it's possible for species to change slightly over small periods of time, but it's not possible for them to change greatly over great periods of time.
Well, yeah,
that's like saying a car can drive 1 mile, but it can't drive 10. I mean, come on.
It's the macro-microevolution argument.
Yeah, and it's bullshit, because
Was Ken Ham in Ecuador, you know, or which would be modern-day Ecuador in the Galapagos, was he there to see Darwin collecting the finches? Because, I mean, I don't really know if Darwin really did collect those finches.
Were you there?
Was he there?
Were you there?
Well, the thing is that if you have slight changes over a short period of time, you'll have great changes over a long period of
time. Right. That's want to talk about the logic of the universe. There's some 101 shit for you. You know, if something can change a little bit in a little period of time, then it can change a lot in a big period of time.
Oh, no, all the changes just go back to the way they were before once you reach...
All different kinds of finches came from one finch, but it was a finch. And it was the finch that God created.
That was the finch on Noah's Ark, right?
The proto-finch.
Yeah.
Thinking about species. Darwin had a much bigger picture in mind. When you look at The Origin of Species, and read that book, you'll find he made this statement. From such low and intermediate form, both animals and plants may have been developed, and if we admit this, we must likewise admit that all organic beings which have ever lived on this earth may be descended from some one primordial form. So he had in mind what we today know as an evolutionary tree of life, that all life has arisen from some primordial form. Now, when you consider the classification system, kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species, we would say, as creationists, and we have many creation scientists who've researched this, and for lots of reasons, I would say the kind in Genesis 1 really is more at the family level of classification. For instance, there's one dog kind, there's one cat kind, even though you have different genera, different species. That would mean, by the way, you didn't need anywhere near the number of animals on the ark as people think. You wouldn't need all the species of dogs, just two, not all the species of cats, just two. And you see, based on the biblical account there in Genesis 1, creationists have drawn up what they believe is a creation orchard. In other words, they're saying, look, there's great variation in the genetics of dogs and finches and so on. And so
and
over
I mean,
time,
look,
particularly...
Actually, he's even cutting the timetable of how fast evolution works short, because if we live in a 6,000-year-old planet, and the only thing that was brought on the ark was just two of any kind of dog, that means that every other species, not species, but every other breed of dog has emerged in the last, like, 4,000 years since then.
Yeah, that's actually something Bill Nye brought up. He said that by your standard, we would have to be finding 7 new species per day. Per day, you would find 7 new ones every day. Over the last 6,000 years, to explain the diversity of species that we have now.
Yeah, and we that's
not to mention
perfectly
Ken,
credible.
Ken Ham is basically acknowledging evolution to be correct by saying, "Oh, well, it does occur, but the timeline is different." It's
and he's basically saying that not everything could come from one original form, but God created all these different, you know, earlier forms. Like, he just created the generalized dog, which I don't know what that was. I mean, we know that dogs evolved from gray wolves, but, you know, I guess...
Well, he says he acknowledges things like DNA and molecules and bacteria, and we can even just look, like, talking about observing we can see thousands of mutations, you know, if not millions of bacteria and fungi and other things, but...
Ignore that.
Yeah, Pay no mind.
We have to ignore that, yeah. I mean, in these organisms that have, like, way shorter lifespans and life cycles, but he's not willing to acknowledge any of that. It's just, no, there was one dog or one cat, you know, and then it just went from there.
After Noah's flood, you'd expect, if there were two dogs, for instance, you could end up with different species of dogs, because there's an incredible amount of variability in the genes of any creature. And so you'd expect these different species up here. But there's limits. Dogs will always be dogs, finches will always be finches. Now, as a creationist, I maintain that observational science actually confirms this model based on the Bible. For instance, take dogs.
And dinosaurs were never...
In a scientific paper...
Birds were never dinosaurs either.
No.
And dogs were never gray wolves. And, yeah.
Dated January 2014, that's this year, scientists working at the University of California stated this: we provide several lines of evidence supporting a single origin for dogs and disfavoring alternative models in which dog lineages arise separately from geographically distinct wolf populations. And they put this diagram in the paper. By the way, that diagram is very, very similar to this diagram that creationists propose based upon the creation account in Genesis. In other words, you have a common dog ancestor that gives rise to the different species of dogs, and that's exactly what we're saying here. Now, in the Creation Museum, we actually show the finches here, and you can see the finches with their different beaks beside dog skulls, different species of dogs. By the way, there's more variation in the dog skulls here than there are in these finches. Yet the dogs, well, that's never used as an example of evolution, but the finches are. Particularly in the public school textbooks, students are taught, see the changes that are occurring here? And here's another problem that we've got.
I think the dogs are actually used as examples of evolution quite often. I've read several books where that was used as an example. Anyway, I think I'm pretty sick of listening to Ken Ham's shit.
Do you want to just listen to the closing arguments?
Yeah, let's skip to the close.
Okay, you'll hear both Bill Nye and Ken Ham. These are the closing arguments of... Actually, there was one last question, and that was basically the closing argument.
Okay.
The question is, what is the one thing, more than anything else, upon which you base your belief?
What is the one thing upon anything else which I base my belief? Well, again, to summarize
Bible.
The things that I've been saying, there is a book... call the Bible. It's a very unique book. It's very different to any other book out there. In fact, I don't know of any other religion that
has
every
hotel
a book
room.
That starts off by telling you that there's an infinite God and talks about the origin of the universe and the origin of matter and the origin of light and the origin of darkness and the origin of day and night and the origin of the earth and the origin of dry land.
Yeah,
there
are no other religions.
No other religion has ever addressed those things.
It's interesting because in the Bible, the origin of light happens before the sun and the stars were created.
Yes, and the origin of light is explained thusly. God said, let there be light, and there was.
The origin of the sun, moon, and stars, the origin of sea creatures, the origin of flying creatures, the origin of land creatures, the origin of man, the origin of woman, the origin of death, the origin of sin, the origin of marriage, the origin of different languages.
But its explanations are all like magic. Why are there animals? Because God was like, animals. Why is there people? God was like, people.
You know, it's kind of funny.
Why are there trees? God was like, trees.
In this debate, Ken Ham claims that all animals on Earth were vegetarians before Noah's flood.
Yes. The mighty lion grazing in the field.
Yep, it did. It was not tempted to eat any of the other animals on the Ark.
Yeah, it saw the antelope and it was like, that's cool, dude. I'm just going to eat some grass.
It wasn't until... Well, I mean, by the ark, we'd already fallen. But, you know, after Adam and Eve took the fruit and ate it, the lion was like, holy shit, you know what would be good now if I just killed the fuck
Satan
out of
probably
like,
tempted
this zebra?
The lion.
Yeah, normally, me and this zebra would be friends. By the way, what decided which animals became predators and which ones didn't? Like, why didn't the zebra say, like, hey, fuck it, I'm going to eat meat now because these two fucking naked humans ate some fruit in a fucking magic garden?
The origin of nations. I mean, it's a very, very specific book, and it gives us an account of a global flood in the history and the Tower of Babel. And if that history is true, then what about the rest of the book? Well, that history also says man is a sinner, and it says that man is separated from God, and it gives us a message that we call the gospel, the message of salvation, that God...
So not only does it say all this other stuff, but it says if you don't believe it, it predicts that it's bullshit and people won't believe it, so that just proves it's true.
Yeah. People will not believe this.
Yeah, what's the penalty for not believing? Well, you're going to go to this place and, you know, burn for all eternity. Have a nice day.
And the fact that you don't believe it shows that it must be true because it predicted that you wouldn't believe it.
You didn't think my house party would be the best party? Well, guess what? It was.
God's son stepped in history to die on a cross, be raised from the dead, and offers a free gift of salvation because the history is true. That's why the message based on history is true. I actually went through some predictions and listed others, and there's a lot more that you can look at, and you can go and test it for yourself. If this book really is true, it is so specific, it should explain the world. It should make sense of what we see.
How?
The flood. Yeah, we
have fossils. How the fuck is the Bible specific? It's, I mean, like, if the Bible was written 2,000 years ago and it was like, hey, the Earth is not the center of the universe, we're just in some random fucking corner of some obscure galaxy among billions of other galaxies, and the sun is just another star, and the little tiny pitiful Earth just kind of circles around it over and over again, and the moon is circling around the Earth, and it, you know, and, you know, here's DNA, and here's how biology works, and here's the fucking sequence of the genome, and here's some advanced mathematical formulas that human beings at this time never could have figured out on their own, then I'd be like, wow, maybe there's something to this fucking book. But instead it's like, hey, there's a snake, and it said, eat the fruit, and they did, and that's why there's sin.
All over the world. The Tower of Babel, yeah, different people groups, different languages. They have flood legends, very similar to the Bible. Creation legends, similar to the Bible. There's so much you can look at, and prophecy, and so on. And most of all, as I said to you, the Bible says, if you come to God believing that He is, He'll reveal Himself to you. You will know. If you search after truth, you really want God to show you, as you would search after silver and gold. He will show you. He will reveal Himself to you.
Yeah, confirmation bias.
Would you repeat the question?
The question is, what is the one thing more than anything else upon which you base your belief?
As my old professor Carl Sagan said so often,
oh, pull out the
when
Carl
you're in love,
Sagan
you
want to card.
Tell the world. And I base my beliefs on the information and the process that we call science. It fills me with joy to make discoveries every day of things I had never seen before. It fills me to joy to know that we can pursue these answers. It is a wonderful and astonishing thing to me that we are, you and I, are somehow at least one of the ways that the universe knows itself. You and I are a product of the universe. It's astonishing. I admit, I see your faces, that we have come to be because of the universe's existence. And we are driven to pursue that, to find out where we came from. And the second question we all want to know, are we alone? Are we alone in the universe? And these questions are deep within us, and they drive us. So the process of science, the way we know nature, is the most compelling thing to me. And I just want to close by reminding everybody what's at stake here. If we abandon all that we've learned, our ancestors, what they've learned about nature and our place in it, if we abandon the process by which we know it, if we eschew, if we let go of everything that people have learned before us, if we stop driving forward, stop looking for the next answer to the next question, we in the United States will be outcompeted by other countries, other economies. Now, that would be okay, I guess, but I was born here. I'm a patriot. And so we have to embrace science education. To the voters and taxpayers that are watching, please keep that in mind. We have to keep science education in science, science classes. Thank
One
you.
One tiny bit.
Yeah, so that was the last thing.
Boo!
Yeah.
Boo,
Bill Nye! Fuck you, Bill Nye!
Fuck you, Bill Nye!
Fuck
yo!
Fuck yo!
Fuck yo, Bill Nye, and your fucking science and shit. The fuck science ever done for us? Eh? Fuck you. You fucking science retard.
Look at him. He's fucking stupid. Look at his fucking face. He's a fucking idiot. Look at him.
People are just mean to Ken Ham because he's an Aussie.
People, yeah, because he has an accent. People just hear his accent and dismiss him.
So, I mean, really, he shredded Bill Nye, and that was the one thing that Bill Nye was like, well, he's from Australia. Well, you know, like, that's weird.
Bill Nye comes out there talking about his evidence and fucking science and the fucking methods and, like, understanding the universe and shit. And Ken Ham is like, you know what, Bill Nye? We already understand the universe.
First of all, Bill Nye, you weren't there.
Yeah, and we have this book.
I wasn't there when it was written.
It's awesome. It explains everything.
I wasn't there with Adam and Eve, but, you know, I'm pretty sure that did happen because we had this Bible and, you know, it's right.
There was a fucking naked guy, and then he was lonely, so God made a naked woman from his rib, and then the woman was deceived by a snake, and she ate some fruit, and that created sin, which was eventually redeemed when God's son, who is also God, was nailed to some sticks and suffered, and then he went to hell for a little while, but then he came back, and he walked on water, and he went to heaven. If we follow him, we'll be fine.
Come on! He sacrificed himself to save us from himself.
Yeah! It makes sense!
All right.